All right, just to catch up, we're studying astrological aspects from various points of view. Because the aspects are probably the most important part of all astrology, and we've been at it, this is the third year. We began studying the aspects in terms of spiritual geometry. We tried to go as deep and as fundamental as we could into the creation of the cosmos in a spiritual, intellectual way as I was capable of, which wasn't too deep. And then we looked at a bunch of classic examples. And then we looked at the aspects as stages in cycles and got a general idea of the aspects being turning points when various things are accomplished within a cycle. This is the way things really are, because planets are constantly in motion, and the horoscope is just a cross-section of one moment in time, and that moment is in time is somewhere in a cycle. In fact, it's somewhere in many cycles, as many as 60 or 70 basic cycles. And then we did a lot of examples of a dynamic view of the aspects. We did that by looking at the lunation cycle, and we looked at examples from various people born at different stages of the lunation cycle. Where we are now currently, we have finished the theoretical part. We're looking at aspects on the astrological mandala. And the astrological mandala is where everything is in standard position. The constellation of Aries is lined up with the sign Aries, which is lined up with the first house. All of the planets in the theoretical mandala are in their home locations. So there are actually two Marses and two Venuses and two Mercuries. So we're saying that the astrological mandala is a symbol of the entire cosmos, especially as seen from a human point of view, human society point of view. And so if we want to understand the classical archetypal application of aspects, we look to the mandala. And that's what we looked at in theory as much as we could. And now we are on the second series of looking at horoscopes with mandalic classics. And in the astrological mandala, Aries, sign and constellation are on the cusp of the first house. This means that the cosmos, as seen in the astrological mandala, is martial in nature. This does not mean that Mars is some super divinity of the creation or anything like that. It just means that the keynote of the cosmos is action. It is an active process of spiritual growth and unfoldment. There is spiritual being that is beyond the cosmos, which you could see in a static way, in eternalist way, but we're not doing that. We're dealing with active cosmos. Our life in general, if it is a cosmic life, is a matter of active participation in the cosmos. And each of our lives is a microcosm or a miniature of the cosmos, and in that regard, our lives are ruled by action. It, in fact, is probably better to have a life in which one makes errors and mistakes and things like that than to have a life where one does nothing at all. At least with errors, through the principle of cause and consequence, you learn from your mistakes, and when you learn from your mistakes, you will be a better person for it. So we're looking at the aspects as being found relative to the cusp of all cusps, which is the cusp of the first house or the cusp of Aries on the mandala. That is the beginning point, and that is the cusp's cusp. And the conjunction aspect is the aspect's aspect. In all astrologies, East and West, the most fundamental aspect is the conjunction, and all of the other aspects are variations on the conjunction. So what we're saying then is that Mars always stays on the first house cusp, and its relationship to the ruler of each of the successive cusps gives an insight in a mandalic way into the nature of those particular aspects. We began with the examples last time of looking at the semi-sextile, the 30-degree relationship, and mandalically that was having the Sun in Aries and Venus on the cusp of Taurus, and producing a 30-degree angle between them. And we tried to get a feel how the assertions of energy projected by Mars precipitated or consolidated the resistance that is represented by Taurus and the second house and things like that. We looked at Mars as being the irrepressible force, and Taurus and the second house and Venus as being the immovable object. This time we're going to look at two aspects, and we're going to really have to race. In fact, by the end, I'll be speaking as fast as my tongue will move because there's so much to do. We're going to begin by looking at the relationship of the first cusp to the third cusp. That is the sextile relationship, the 60-degree relationship, and we're going to look at first sextiles between Mars and Mercury. That is when Mercury is forward from Mars in the zodiac rather than when it is backward from it. Hello. Hi, Ella. All right. And as always, when we do this, there are quite a few different ways that someone can look at an aspect. And we're going to try to look at several of them and get as many different points of view as we can. And if we continue along the line of thought that we've been following, we will follow what happens after the irresistible force meets the immovable object. We're talking about the Gemini stage. And what happens is that there is a reverberation when an irresistible force meets an immovable object. And that reverberation is a communication between the object and the force. It's sort of like if you take a hammer and hit an anvil or hit a piece of granite or something like that, you feel the reverberation going right up your arm. And we're talking about simple communication, simple direct communication without any sophistication or anything like that. It's something like the communication that takes place between a taxi cab driver and a dispatcher rather than a telephone call between teenagers, which can go on for hours and talk about all sorts of things. Everything has to be completed and everything has to be cleared. Now, we have said all along that the aspects represent tools. Tools are the means of getting things done. And in the way we're looking at it, we're looking at tools for the creation of the cosmos or the creation of a society or the creation of an individual life. Now, if you strike something like a piece of railroad rail or an anvil with a hammer, you feel the reverberation. You feel it in your bones. There is a buzz. And that is what the first sextile between Mars and Mercury are like. Now, in life, this represents first real application. And when you're beginning, there are all sorts of things that you can try out. And so what this represents, beyond a beginner's luck, it represents sorting out all kinds of different tools and seeing if they work well. So the Mars sextile to Mercury is a classic for being a jack of all trades. These are people who can do many, many different things. And so we'll begin looking at one of the greater jacks of all trades in history. Sir Francis Bacon. Strangely as it might seem, even though it's five centuries old, or almost five centuries old, the horoscope is very good. It comes from William Lilly, the great British astrologer, who was a contemporary of Bacon, and he got good data on it. Mars, in this case, is in the ninth house. And it's a strong position for Mars. Mars likes the fiery signs. It does get a little pugnacious in the fiery signs that are not Aries, but that's Mars anywhere. Anyway, in this horoscope, the Mars sextile Mercury is the strongest aspect in the horoscope. It's just a half a degree between the two planets. The ninth house is the house of judgment and of justice. And Sir Francis Bacon was a state's attorney. He was the prosecuting attorney for the Crown of England. And as such, he set a lot of precedents because he developed many ingenious lines of prosecution, and that ability to try different things and to bring new things in is very much a Mars-Mercury type of quality. And having Uranus in the ninth house indicates an innovator who would be very creative in doing this kind of judicial activity. Now, Mars conjoins the midheaven, which means that though he had a philosophy of action, that philosophy of action carried into professionalism, and it carried him into fame. He was famous for his statecraft. Now, the ninth house, many say, is a house not only of philosophy, but any kind of higher organized understanding of things. And some people say that the ninth house rules science, or what happens in science. For me, the jury is still out on that, that I don't really know whether it's true or not. But in this case, it appears to be so, because Sir Francis Bacon was one of the people that anticipated the British empiricists. And he did a great deal. He was very outspoken to promote the philosophy of science, having rigorously tested hypothesis to prove or disprove something. And he was very much an empiricist. Mercury conjoined the ascendant, or straddling the sun, straddling the ascendant with the sun, is somebody that would be very big about empirical evidence, things using the senses. So this is quite an accurate chart. He couldn't escape from the Mercury in the 12th house, the downside. With all of the planets in air signs, with so many planets in air signs, the sun, the ascendant, Mercury, Saturn, he was prone to some of the air sign problems. Air sign problems include a kind of neutralism, a neutralism that is often amoral. I happen to be an expert about that because I was married to a amoral Aquarian, and somebody that thought that nudism and exhibitionism were perfectly natural things. And if anybody had a problem with it, it was because in their own consciousness. And she was sort of like an innocent about it. I don't want to make her sound bad or anything like that. So there is something, you know, Gemini will woodgy one way or another with the truth of something. You know, they can argue on both sides of things. And there's that quality about the air signs. And so what happened is he brought a lot of shame on himself, because as much as he was an innovator, he was expedient. And that's another quality of Mars sextile Mercury, is expedience. And he was known to take gifts from people who he was prosecuting. And he got himself into all kinds of trouble with corruption and things like that.
His birthday is January 22nd, but why is the sun at 12 degrees?
What?
If his birthday is January 22nd, why is the sun at 12 degrees?
Oh, maybe it's written in there. Oh, it's the old style calendar. It's the old style calendar. Well, there was a change because Julius Caesar was influenced by Egyptian astrologers, and the Egyptian astrologers used a cycle of Sothis, and the cycle of Sothis did not take add an extra year for leap years, because they had a whole cycle that many thousands of years until the calendar came back to being exact again, and Julius Caesar just took the stuff of it, and so the Julian calendar does not have leap years in it, and things got way out of balance until finally they Gregory we had the Gregorian calendar, and so everything got shifted off because Easter was happening at a very odd time of the year, and it wasn't an Easter-like time of the year. But at any rate, he was an excellent writer, and writing, in order to be successful, has to be strong. It has to carry energy to it, and this is what Mars sextile Mercury does. It carries you along. I've read quite a few essays by him, and he was a very excellent writer, but he certainly was not Shakespeare, because he uses a very different style from Shakespeare. And he's not at all as deep as Shakespeare is, and doesn't even go into the same subjects in his own writing. It is clear that he had a very strong Rosicrucian influence, and that's many people have agreed with that. All right. We're taking way too long. We may be here till the middle of the night. All right. Sometimes the facility of communication that takes place between Mars and Mercury is simple and spare. Sometimes it goes beyond that. It is primitive. And if one of the planets happens to be in an Earth sign, it is downright earthy. It is not only down to Earth, it is downright earthy. And so we're talking about here a simple communication that is called the blues. And this is the blues singer, Bonnie Raitt. We see here that there are four Earth sign planets, and the Sun and Mercury are in Scorpio, which combination sort of tends toward being bluesy. Jupiter is weak, so this is not a cheery character. It's not a ha-ha happy horoscope. Saturn is strong, and it sextiles Mercury. And that tends toward the sober and the somber, but not necessarily tragic. Now, if we look, Mars, which is one of the planets we're trying to get at, is in Virgo, and it's trine to Venus. And that adds the element of love, and certainly earthy kind of love. And together with the Sun and Mercury in Scorpio, it brings a focus of love and love problems into the whole mix. Now, Aries is rising, and Mars is energetic. And in the fifth house, it shows that the energies are thrown into expression. And for her, expression is as much as communication in its importance. And so the Mars sextile Mercury, she is somebody who is very straightforward, very clean, very forceful in her manner of communication and expression. Now, the blues is not known for poetic efflorescence in its lyrics, but it's known more for terse statements of anguish, and she gets that. For some, the blues are a relief values, and for others, they actually excite happiness. And though she's not really a really happy, a jocular type of person, she gets more happiness out of the blues than she gets the blues herself or the sorrow herself. I find this to be that people who are not African American are more inclined to treat the blues as something happy rather than as something painful and sorrowful that they're just expressing in themselves. The Sun and Mercury are in the seventh house, and it's clear, especially since a lot of the planets are in the west, that she sings for the listener as much as for herself, and that is her whole way of looking at things. So it's easy to see from the horoscope why this would be a good calling for her. Now, expedience, as we have said, is one of the things of Mars sextile Mercury. But expedience is not always such a good thing, especially when the expedience is used to serve the will, the power. And the next horoscope is the horoscope of someone who is a votary of the will to power. Uncle Donnie, the torturer. At first, it's not really easy to see how ruthless he can be. And Sagittarius is rising, and he seems rather amiable on first meeting. Jupiter, which is the ruler of the ascendant, which is in Uranus, which shows a kind of a quirkiness, and he can throw things at you and make you feel happy quite easily. And even the Sun in Cancer gives him something of a softness, something like a grandfather or somebody avuncular or something like that. But when you start getting to Mars conjoined Pluto, and both of them are square to Uranus, you see that there is a coldness and a ruthlessness. And in the eighth house, he knows how to hide it. Sun, he knows how to keep it secret.
Sun conjoined Pluto.
What?
Yeah, okay. You said Mars.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sun conjoined Pluto, yes. And so you can see that even Uranus is in the fourth house, and that's another secretive kind of house. And so everything is not as it appears first on the surface. The Moon conjoins the midheaven, and it is trine to Saturn, which shows that he has very good emotional control in the service of power. But that isn't necessarily morality, it's emotional control. The Moon squares Venus in a mutual reception square, which somehow shows that he does not have an understanding of the feminine, and perhaps even has a disdain for the feminine. And perhaps that might even be part of the reason for his power seeking. Now, there are a lot of talents in this horoscope, but his life showed that he used them to serve a reactionary point of view. Pluto is definitely reactionary. That goes beyond conservative, trying to go back to a past that never was. And he used them to serve secret power. And his use of them in secret power may be so secret that we will never know the things that he was all involved with. It's that kind of secrecy. Now, Mars sextile Mercury is the tool that served the will to power. Again, it's a matter of expedience. And even more than in the Bonnie Raitt chart, there are all these planets on the western side of the horoscope. And when they're on the west, this shows that he was a team player. And so he was capable then of spreading disinformation and being very voluble about it and being able to serve what the gang wanted. We're talking here about Wolfowitz and George Bush and all of those people in that very right-wing view of things. He always had a ton of facts, and he had a sharp, speedy mind that he could dole those facts out quite easily, but he used them to keep a secret. All right. Let's stick with power and deception. Of course, my heart gets a flutter as soon as I put the horoscope up. Pluto is close to the ascendant. So it's in the 12th house, so it's a kind of unseen power. Contrary to what might be expected, it is probably not a sexual power or influence. Much more a mental power and influence. And it is also not necessarily an immoral power and influence, even though the roles that she has taken would seem to indicate something other than that. She really is quite a high-minded person. Pluto is in an almost exact sextile to Jupiter. And when you have Jupiter and Pluto together in a sextile like that, they are always a force for the good. And they sextile and trine. The sextile includes Neptune. So there is something of a Neptune, beside being sensitive and spiritual, Neptune is very often super idealistic. On the other hand, Pluto is in an even more exact square to the moon. And that is very, very problematic. And it indicates struggles with instincts carried almost into obsession. In fact, I would believe that somewhere along the line she has a sexual obsession, or an obsession of some kind. I would hope it would be sexual if she was with me. It's something that has to deal with her home life, probably with her original family, and things that come up from her basic unconscious. And this is where that whole idea of basic instinct comes up. It's not necessarily the sexual thing, it's the obsession, and it's the obsession of trying to, I don't know how you carry out or work with things that are instinctual. Mars, again, is in an earthy sign in Capricorn, which is its exaltation, and from there it sextiles Mercury up in Pisces. And so there is, like Bonnie Raitt, an earthy quality to her. However, the sun is in Pisces, which it may have a quality of tragedy about it. It isn't raw as it would be like when it's in Scorpio. The understanding of Mars and Mercury is complicated by the square of Saturn to Mercury, which is almost of the same strength. Since the Mars sextile Mercury is within the span of the square of Mercury and Saturn, this shows that it's something internal. It's part of an internal process of some kind of regenerative activity, probably by staying very clear and short and direct. She's trying to overcome the tendency to dishonesty, which is indicated by Mercury square Saturn. And I think that's a really interesting philosophy to go about it, because if things get long and convoluted and entangled as they can with Pisces, that's a hard, you know, there's always a lie in there somewhere, or there's some kind of self-dishonesty or something like that. And limiting herself to short, curt statements is probably a good strategy to work it out. So this is a very complicated horoscope to understand. It's not you know, there's too much in it. Five of the planets are in the fourth, the eighth, or the 12th, and those are things hidden. You can't, it's very hard to see them. You have to infer what they are and then find out how they surface through other things, and not necessarily only in the unconscious activities. The Sun is in Pisces, and it's mildly square to Saturn, but indicates that the lies are in the service, probably, of selfishness. Pisces can be morally lax, or it can be easily compromised, and she did that. She forwarded her career by being a Playboy centerfold, and she probably has the tendency to lie to herself. And that's the tough, you know, that's probably the basis of all lies, is not being true to ourselves. And that's what she worked with. The Uranus opposite Venus shows her to sometimes be a misguided altruist. She is a very charitable person, but sometimes it's misguided. And the misguidance is that she might be doing it as a compensation for other things about herself that she's not sure of. Strange as it may seem, she, like Gina Davis, is a very intelligent person. She has a Mensa IQ of 154. And that's saying something. Very often, though, people who have high IQs, in having to deal with it self-consciously, have a very hard time rationalizing to it. I once gave a series, an evening talk, which turned out to be all questions and answers to the Madison Mensa Society. And the questions that were asked were the most childish questions. I've actually given talks to Baptist Sunday schools where I got better questions than I did from the Mensa people. There is a correlation, though. This is a good example for Mars sextile Mercury, in that there is a correlation between IQ and speed. And that, you know, people who think faster are likely to do better on IQ tests, even though they might have the same intelligence as somebody else. So she's not a bad person. She probably does have some ambition problems, but it's, you know, in stating something like this, it's hard to work with it, because, you know, this is worth a study of a few sessions anyway. And with that Virgo rising and that exact degree that Mercury is in Venus, she might be a good match for me if she ever could find out about me. Maybe I should
write her
a fan letter. Facebook. As we said earlier, Mars sextile Mercury is a jack of all trades aspect. And Mars sextile Mercury is probably the most flexible and adaptable of all the aspects. And adaptability, flexibility, is one of the chief abilities necessary for evolution, personal evolution and general evolution. Now, we're not going to say very much about the next horoscope, except that it points out a great adaptability. Horoscope of Bonnie Langford. Does everybody know who she is? Mars and Venus, Mars being one of the planets that we're especially interested in, is in the first house. And that thing, planets in the first house, especially Mercury, but Mars and Venus also, indicate precocity. Her first appearance on stage was at age 4 months. At age 15 months, she danced on stage with specially made dance shoes. At 6, she won her first talent show, and then her career took off. She's responsible for her recorded work of the musical Cats, and she has done the audio for Doctor Who, and of all things, she has toured as a pantomime. And Mars and Venus are important to this. In fact, they're important to all of the arts because Mars gives the guts. If you have only Mars, you have an engineer. And if you have only Venus, you have an aesthete that is doesn't have much to them. And so when you put Mars and Venus together, you have the artistic qualities with verve. She has starred on Broadway. She's acted in film. And she has acted on TV. And on top of that, for flexibility, she toured with an ice skating show. So having both of those, especially in Gemini, being sextile to Mercury, shows extreme adaptability. Mercury, though, however, is square to Jupiter, which shows an excess and potential trouble. The sun is unaspected except for a quincunx to the moon, which doesn't count for a whole lot. So this indicates that her problem might be that she overdid talents. And she put, when she came to rebirth, she put everything into developing all of these talents and nothing into self-knowing or self-understanding. It's an interesting character to look at. Now, the seventh house is the house of open enemies. In the next horoscope, Mars in the first opposes Jupiter in the seventh, so the pride of this man made him many open enemies. And he was daring enough to do what he did in order to produce open enemies. The Indian writer Salman Rushdie, who is not anti-Muslim, in fact, is a Muslim himself. Many critics claim, especially British critics, that he probably, of living authors of a literary variety, has perhaps the best command of the English language of any living writer. And after studying for several years with Anu Galag, or whatever her name is, that does the, the place where you have the words of the day and the trace the etymologies and things like that. She's from India also. Gemini has a way with words in quite a few planets, 4 planets in Gemini. And Mercury is the ruler of Gemini, and it's trine to Jupiter, which indicates again somebody very wordy. And it's in water signs, so this is somebody that has a feel for language, that chooses words not with the intellect, but chooses words with the feeling. Venus and Gemini sextile Saturn and Pluto, and it trines Neptune. And Saturn and Neptune and Venus are all pretty imaginative planets. And the Neptune indicates that there's a very, the Venus trine Neptune indicates a kind of a delicate imagery. And the positions of Pluto and Saturn indicate that she can sustain a delicate, or he can sustain a delicate imagination long enough to concretize it, to make it something tangible. And very excellent use of it all. Uranus is in Gemini, and it's conjoined to the sun and the moon, and it's 1/2 hour before a new moon, and it is virtually a new moon. So with this Uranus combination, it indicates a high creativity, and the second house position of it all is indicates the ability to objectify it all. In order to keep the interest of the reader, you have to stimulate. And the Uranus semi-sextile to Mercury indicates a budding capacity at creative verbalization. This is especially so if you write long books, as Salman Rushdie does. You have to constantly be putting new things in there, or you lose your reader before another 150 pages have gone by. Now, we're ready to jump into the Mars square moon, and hang on to your seats, because it's not easy stuff to deal with. Now, there are various ways that you can think about the astrological mandala, and each way that you look at it is fruitful. It gives understanding for life. The way we're looking at it as Mars ruling all the aspects by ruling the first house cusp. This is common. This goes all the way back to India, doing things like that. The first and seventh cusps form a horizontal line through the mandala. Physically, everything below that line, which is the horizon, is the sensible earth that we can't even see through. And everything above is the heavens. So you could say that everything below is of the earth, earthy. It is personal. It is subjective. The deepest beneath the earth, if you look, is Cancer. And that is a very subjective viewpoint of things. Everything above the earth is for the universe. It's sort of impersonal. Everything is judged by society or is judged by the world, and that's altogether different, that kind of objectivity, than what you have in your subjective feelings. So when we try to understand and explore the Mars square moon, we're going to look at some of these metaphoric guidelines. Now, Mars represents energy, and energy is energy. Mars in Aries in the first represents raw energy. It's neither high nor low, neither good nor bad, it's just energy. You can use the energy to kill somebody, or you can use the energy to help someone. In terms of evolution, if you take the whole spectrum of planets, Mars, along with the Moon and Saturn, are considered primitive planets. And to be characterized, to be characterized as identifying with energy, is considered primitive. This is the kind of people that ride motorcycles just for the energy of the experience. Whereas, if a person is identified with thought or with intuition, that's certainly not primitive. So though energy per se is neutral, in many ways in humans, because the spectrum of the planets, as we look at the spectrum of the planets, is a reflection of a way we look at human beings. And so it is often primitive. And when we come into squares, especially with another primitive like the moon, we are going to run into primitive activities. The Mars square moon, where the moon is in the deepest part of the mandala, everything is personal and subjective and decidedly primitive. So the Mars square moon can be associated with things like breeding. It's almost an unconscious activity, such that when people enter into personal activities unconsciously, it's a much different thing. And this is something that I have found throughout life, that people who have Mars square moon, when they are sexually fluent, they are sexually fluent, and they consider it that this is natural. It's not something that, you know, it happens and they don't even think about it. Like the muscles go into action and they're in coition, and it's very, very fluent, and it is not something that is deliberated. There are higher manifestations and lower manifestations to Mars square moon, and we'll look at all of them, but we'll begin with something that is a little on the lower side. Now, sometimes when a person jokes, it's not clear whether the person is joking or not. Sometimes even the joker doesn't know whether they're joking or not. Now, the next horoscope is the part is someone who has played the part for artistic sake and for life's sake of a primitive. And one doesn't know whether she really is primitive or not. The horoscope of the rap artist Queen Latifah. In fact, she's a movie star, and she's done quite good with, quite well with a lot of things. My favorite reference to Queen Latifah is from the Onion newspaper. They have the picture of this big, burly black man. He's wearing an animal skin, and he's got a big spear, and the caption underneath says, King Latifah comes looking for Queen. All three of the primitive planets, the Mars, the Saturn, and the Moon, are in a T-square with Jupiter. Mars and Saturn sitting right above the ascendant, and Jupiter in the sixth house, and the Moon down in the fourth house. So she talks rap primitively. And if all three primitives are in a square, including the square we're most looking at, is Mars square the moon, is she really primitive? Sun opposes Pluto. And that's usually somebody who gets into battles of will. And in the common signs, and especially from the 12th house, she probably loses her battles of will. The Sun is closing in on a trine to Neptune. And Neptune is both the dispositor and the depositor of the Sun. And this shows a true but hidden spirituality. Venus is trine the Moon. So she is indeed very feminine, very receptive. But that gets hidden also because of the 12th house. Mercury opposes Pluto, so she confounds and she boggles her mind. And I'm not really familiar with her rap songs. I should have taken the time to listen to some of them. But one would expect with Mercury opposite Pluto, one would expect some of the rapping was just non sequiturs. Just meant to blow your mind with the power of the words or something of that nature. I would, if I get a chance, I'll try to do that.
I have a couple memorized.
You do? Yeah, say one.
I think Latifah, she has one, U-N-I-T-Y, that's a unity, U-N-I-T-Y. Who you calling a bitch? or Nazi, what? You gotta let them know you ain't a bitch or a hoe. You could be getting into these power battles. She was a feminist rapper,
yes.
So she took on the misogyny.
Oh, wonderful. See, that clarifies it. Hey, Ray, hooray.
While you're talking, yes. And then, you know, she is super cute, like Eula said, and super feminine.
Yeah.
But because of her stance that she took on this.
Okay. Well, now you'll hear my take. So it's hard to tell whether she's really tough and primitive or whether she's using that to protect her sensitivity. I tend to think that the primitive T-square is on the surface, and that's being pushed out from being buried in the character by the spirituality is pushing it out. And when you have that many planets in the 12th house, it's like you're just packed under all kinds of things from past lives, and she's pushing that out. And if she's doing it artistically, and especially if she's doing out it, bringing it out in a positive way like that, is a very good thing. All right. Let's, while we're looking at things that are questionable or questionable in their primitivity, whether they really are primitive or not, let's look at another one in that line. This is the horoscope of the materialistic Darwinist philosopher Herbert Spencer. We have spoken about this horoscope before. When we spoke about sensitivity, he was sensitive to the times with the Uranus and Neptune conjoined in Capricorn on the ascendant. He was sensitive to what was going on in the world around him, but because there was that strong Earth sign influence, he sensed the materialism of his time and became an outspoken materialist. He was a prominent voice for materialism and Darwinism in Europe. Very strong influence on most of the intellectuals in Europe during his decade of great prominence. The moon, which we're looking at, is in the ninth house, the house of philosophy. And it's in a fixed sign T-square with the Sun and Mars. Now this seems to indicate that despite all of his effort to be a sensible intellect, he was probably an outright emotional dogmatist. That he'd get into dogmatic arguments and wouldn't budge on anything. And in this, the moon Mars shows emotional turbulence, and it shows a sort of a steady or fixed boil to it. And it shows that this was not only intellectual. This has almost an evangelistic fervor about it. And so he certainly believed in the survival of the fittest, in the Mars and the moon, and that way you fight for what you want to progress through, you know, in evolution, but it's theoretical for him. And it's more a matter of philosophy than it is actually a matter of physical reality. So what it seems is that he's sublimating his primitivity into the survival of the fittest, and in that, because he still believes that, the sublimation isn't really successful in regenerating the character. The Sun in the seventh substitutes struggle for cooperation. Now,
Mars
in the seventh, I'm sorry. Now, sometimes a given combination, the same kind of combination, can mean different things in different lives and different horoscopes. The next horoscope also has Mars square the moon from the seventh to the ninth house. In this case, it means something of a philosophy of wildness and whoopee. This is the horoscope of... Yeah, he's really something. This is Keith Richards, a man so debauched that he used to change his blood the way people change oil in their car. He would sit down for a transfusion and take the dirty blood out of it that had heroin and everything else, and he'd get a complete change of blood. He had the money to do it, and he would be rejuvenated. Mars is conjoined to Uranus, and both of them are square to the moon. And Mars and the moon are primitive, and in this case, it is the primitivity works out through the rhythm function. He was not a drummer, but it is the rhythm that got to him. From childhood on, very early childhood on, he was involved with the rhythm and blues movement, especially the rhythm part of it. Uranus also trines Neptune, so it indicates he could probably be pretty creative about the rhythmic forces that he used, the patterns that he used. Mars and Moon are one of the primitive. There are three qualities to music. There is melody, there is harmony, and there is rhythm. Melody relates to the individual statement of the spirit. Harmony relates to the Christ function, and rhythm relates to the individual spirit, the lower of the three parts of Trinity. And it is, in this case, it's inverted into primitivity. Mars, the moon, for example, in Cancer, especially the sun conjoined moon in Cancer, is sometimes a symbol of a percussionist because they get into all of those rhythmic kinds of qualities. All right. The moon sextiles Venus, which indicates a benign imagination, and it indicates a kind of sophistication. And so he's not completely a base man. Saturn opposes the sun, and it's the blues side of the rhythm and the blues in the same way that the Mars square moon is the rhythm side. So he can identify with the downtrodden. The sun also trines Jupiter in the ninth house, which shows a philosophy of celebration. And that's really what he was and what his life still is. He's much milder. He's in self-destructive now. But that's the whole side of his being. That is, let's celebrate. Let's have a good time. But you can get carried away doing that. It's an easy thing to do if you have many millions of dollars. But maybe it's not such a good way to regenerate yourself, because with that much money, you know, it's a big temptation. All right. Oh. Sometimes the sun square moon goes beyond primitivity. The next horoscope has the Mars square the moon as by far the strongest aspect in the horoscope, so it is dominant. But it isn't necessarily pleasant. Everybody knows who Myra Hindley is. Her biography, the title of her biography was called Beyond Belief. When she was a young woman in her late teens, she fell in love with a man named Ian Brady. In this case, the Mars is sextile Venus, and that's a falling in love aspect. And in this case, her falling in love, she abetted his Mars, the Mars square moon. The sun is sextile to Neptune, but that's no indication of spirituality, but plenty of weirdness. During her trial, when she was on trial, she wore lilac hair for part of the trial, and then in a later part of the trial, she wore banana yellow hair. She had a fascination with Ian Brady, who was a very glib man, And she let herself be ruled by him. He took pornographic pictures of her, and he got her to support his idea of a perfect murder. Now, there are no other strong aspects other than the Mars square moon, which is a very close orb, less than a degree, so it's very strong. And it became manifest with nothing else to restrain it. It became manifest as a bloodlust. She and Ian Brady murdered at the minimum 6 children between 7 and 17 years of age. After they had murdered them, they were all male and female. And after they murdered them, they were buried on the heath. And she was the lure because she could charm people, Venus in the first house being a charming kind of person. And there's nothing in the horoscope that indicates some kind of bizarre fascination that this was a psychological thing. With her, it was just something primitive. Base emotions took over, and she became wild. And it is a fact that I knew a man that belonged to a devil cult, and in order to be initiated into that devil cult, he had to take someone's life. And when you take someone's life, especially if you do that with your own hands, it gives you a kind of occult power, especially if there is blood let in the process, and especially if one consumes the blood after it has been let. And so we're talking about someone here who has a bloodlust. It got really strange. The lust just took over. They did pornographic acts on some of the people before, during, and after their murders. And many of the victims suffered horrible abuse, which was recorded on tape. This was before there was video recording. I told you it was going to be not the most pleasant of all nights to deal with. We've been saying all along that sometimes things aren't what they seem to be or what they are said to be, and this is one of those cases. Only there's a spelling error in the creation of the horoscope. It's supposed to be Dominique Aure, which is a pen name. The true name was Annie Desclos, and she had another pen name called Pauline Rayage. She is an early erotic writer whose most famous work was The History of O, which took over all of Europe, and it's known in the United States only through the film. But her real work was that she was a literary person involved with publishing and writing. And she was married to a man who was a publisher, and they were out with friends, and they were sitting around a table talking, and her husband said, no woman could write an erotic novel. It's something that only a man could do. And so she set out to prove him wrong. I've never read the work, but I would question whether she really did. I would even question the world's judgment. It was pretty bad, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, okay. Ooh. Well, that fits right in with, oh, I wish I had more. You can never get enough biographical information for doing these things. She certainly knows what love is because the sun is conjoined to Venus, and she identifies with love, and she's probably romantic. It's probably a philosophical view of things. But she's also very mental and very verbal. And it's been my experience that people who have the sun in Virgo with regard to personal things like diet and sexuality and hygiene and things like that, like to use arguments, well, my dog eats that, so it must be natural. Or my dog eats in that fashion, so it must be natural. This is very often a sun in Virgo way of looking at things. That seems to be the case here. Mars is a square to the moon, which has the quality of no restraint, especially of sexual urges, because they are considered natural. And in the Freudian sense, they are considered healthy. That's his argument about it all. And it even has an element of conflict. So what Lou said about being masochistic and passive at the same time indicates that is very likely so. What seems to take place is that the earthy experience is part mental experience. And so if it can't, the mind can never be satisfied. Earthy things, you know, all of our senses tire out. You know, after a few minutes of eating, the sense of taste tires out. It's the quickest one to go into sensory fatigue. Even before smell, it shuts down. So in the mind, you can think a thought over again and again. But if, what she may have tried to say is that she was romantic and she was an excellent person, and some of this may have been her personal background, but she has is confused about that. Now, in my life, I have known several nymphomaniacs and reputed nymphomaniacs, and each and every one of them had the sun in Virgo, and it was a mental thing. That it wasn't really a sensual thing, it's that they thought that they should be earthy, and they thought that they should be erotic. So I tend to think that this is, in fact, literary. There may be a quality that is autobiographical to it, and it could, as Lou Avers, it could be masochistic.
The book is sadomasochistic.
It is.
Yeah. Okay. But I didn't necessarily
think that she was.
No.
Okay. So it is more mental than anything. All right.
That was helpful.
All right. This is somebody, another individual with sexual complexity. Ray Charles. A man. By this time, we're so running out of time that I just, the race through to get all the horoscopes in. He was blind from the age 6 with glaucoma, and by age 11, he was orphaned. He managed 3 marriages and 4 children, doing what comes naturally, as the song says. Not only was he completely fluent in love, we have Mars trine Venus again here, and Mars square the moon, he has that artistic quality, and he really, truly loved women. That's almost an exact 1 minute away from a partile or exactly accurate trine. So he really did fall in love with women and loved them, and they came from his own friends, and he was willing to partner with all of them. Now, his fluency and his hypersexuality is much more complex than that, because Mars is square to the moon, and it's part of a 5-planet T-square. Mars, Moon, Jupiter, Pluto, Uranus. 3 of the planets are in Cancer, so there's a very strong lunar element to it. And his creative perfection was probably, with the Pluto part of it, mixed up with obsession. And I tend to think that all of it is trying to make up for a missing mother. That's a thesis that is, I think, overused, but in this case, I think it is a viable thesis. And all of the other emotions, he's very excellent, artistic and creative about them, but there's a difficulty in trying to please his mother and trying to feel like he has done what he couldn't do for her when she was alive. So he has an extreme talent in sound, and that is indicated by the Sun trine Mercury, because people who have a Sun trine Saturn, I find that people who are sensitive to pitch, are all of the Earth signs are very strong in that way. All right. Let's look at another one with mother domination. Extreme mother domination. Probably most in this generation do not know who Jean Harlow was. Yes, this is the woman that, for whom the term the blonde bombshell was coined. And she was one of those lovelies that Howard Hughes kept in his stable. And for her, he coined the term platinum blonde. So this is the first platinum blonde. The roles that she played in the movies were of a lusty, sex-driven woman who manipulated men. And her roles were like her life, very much like her life, except that she got the worst of it. Sometimes that happened in the movies, too. She was sent to a boarding school when she was a child, but she ran away and she married the son of a wealthy investment broker. The marriage didn't last very long, because his parents broke it up, and it was most likely the mother that did it. Howard Hughes got a glimpse of her and made a star out of her. And her second marriage was a marriage, the moon is in the seventh house, both of the moon and Venus are in the seventh house, indicating that her femininity is very much a matter of her marriages. And we're looking at the moon, which is in a sextile to Pluto, in a square to Neptune, and in a square to Mars, which is the primary aspect we're looking at, and perhaps by association, even square to Uranus. It's not a pretty life. The Uranus part comes in that in her second marriage, she married a movie executive. And this movie executive also kept a mistress in New York City. And she found out on the wedding night that he couldn't perform sexually without a dildo. And she laughed him to scorn, and she flushed it down the toilet. And the episode was enough that he supposedly committed suicide. But there are witnesses that say that his mistress from New York came and visited, and that she got away with murder. She said that she craved natural sex, and she wanted a child. But what happened is, the Mars Neptune is a very charismatic aspect. And when you throw the moon in there, there is that primitive quality that is kind of charismatic, with it's kind of a biological spooky kind of thing, that you know you're not playing with somebody with a, you know, with a deck that isn't loaded. And so she wanted natural relations, and she married a cameraman, a commoner, and her mother broke that marriage up and said she should be married to somebody with power and wealth and celebrity. This is a case of a dominating mother or energy being applied, Mars square to the moon, a dominant kind of mother. She was later engaged to William Powell, but her health failed her, and she died at age 26. Yeah.
Who was the one who thought you got away with murder?
The mistress.
The mistress.
The mistress in New York, yeah. All right, let's stay with the movies. The next character is more than we have time for, way more than we have time for. It's a character that I have been fascinated with, both attractively and repulsively. Federico Fellini. The way he related to women was through his wife. We're talking about the moon as ruling women in general, and we're talking about a rejuvenescence through natural force indicated by the moon square Mars. His statement that he made several times in life was, "I was born the day I met her." His wife being an actress, and the first day he met her, he was born. Now, coition is a natural function, but not in and for itself. In its natural function, it's for the perpetuation of life through reproduction. Mars is in the house of products, things that are produced. And the fifth house is the house of expression. So what it seems like here is that he channels the instinctual drive into personal creativity with vigorous enthusiasm, with a kind of primal vigor. And a lot of the themes, even though they're made to be very artistic, a lot of the themes of his movies are quite primal. There's an aspect, part of the square that we haven't looked at so far. Part of the square is that it is a block. Moon square Mars is the least blocked, unlike on the other side, Saturn square Mars is heavily blocked. But when there is blockage, the temperamental side of Mars comes out. This is not murderous like we looked at Myra Headley. This is temperamentality. This is one of those famous temperamental Italian movie directors. He blows up. It's over quickly, but he blows up. The Mars trine Uranus, Mars trine Uranus is somebody who is very fleet and very flexible. And with his intuition, he can just see how it's supposed to go. And he can produce a line of energy and action that this is the way it is supposed to be. But when it doesn't go that way, especially because it involves somebody's emotions, he blows up. It's so this is what his life is. His life is an expression of this boundless energy that has to be expressed, even if it has to be expressed primitively. But all of his movies are extremely exaggerated. And that brings in, you know, the theater, the fifth house is personal expression. The 11th house is impersonal expression. And all of his movies have exaggerated themes or exaggerated ideas. And it's like, it's the things are so exaggerated that they become gargoyle, that they look ugly. At least that's the way it's always appeared to me in his films. And so we're what we're looking at here is a very, very complicated type of person. That's why I said we should take a long time with this, but we aren't going to. So.
I do have a question.
Yes.
Can you explain one blocked versus not blocked?
It depends on the individual. It's very rare that Mars square moon indicates a block, but the block is always a potential in the square, and it depends on how the individual uses it. And I think that in this case, it is a block because the emotionality can't keep up with the speed of the Mars trine Uranus, which is the intuition, and it's there instantaneously, like an electric shock. And if the emotions can't keep up with that, especially if you're dealing with actresses that won't do what you want them to do, then there's the explosion. It's more of a thwarting than a blocking, I guess you would say. All right. Oh, we are going to get this in within 90 minutes. I hope to get it in 75 minutes. Now, I've had a lot of experience with different Mars aspects. And one of the experiences that I've had is with a woman who miscarried because her womb was too acid. So sometimes when you put the Mars together, which is hot, with the moon, which is fluidic, that means acid. Now, I couldn't find somebody that was literally acidic. It's hard to get that kind of detailed information. And the horoscope that I dealt with a woman that was having miscarriages was about 40 years ago, so I couldn't dig that out of my memory. This is somebody who, the horoscope was somebody who is often acid-mouthed.
Oh, man. Oh, my gosh. And it's acid to her face.
we should not be too harsh. This is a living person. Things, sometimes comics are comedic because they juxtapose truth with falsity, or truth with reality. Sometimes the false statement that accompanies truth is understatement. That's usually more like British humor. Sometimes, as in this case, it's overstatement. American humor is often overstatement. Mars conjoins Jupiter, and that's exaggerative. And they're in the dusty, dry sign Virgo, and they both square the moon in Sagittarius, which is an exaggerative sign. Now, if it were exaggeration alone, it would be like clowning or buffoonery, and that may or may not be humorous. The effect of humor is that it has to be pointed. And in this case, it is pointed by the sun trine Saturn. She can hit the nail on the head, but the sun trine Saturn is not strong enough relative to the square in order for it to be understatement. So the sun trine Saturn in this case is accuracy, and the accuracy is so that the overstatement that she makes is appropriate to the situation. Sometimes the trines can indicate exaggeration, but in this case it represents a measured kind of consciousness. Uranus is rising, and that's kind of a zaniness. And it sextiles Venus and Mercury, and that Uranus sextile Mercury is excellent ability for ad-libbing. And so she's very good at that. Uranus in the first house also indicates artificiality in appearance, and that's that plastic surgery. But for her, it's more of artificiality. A few years ago, we looked at Michael Jackson's chart, and Michael Jackson's chart, it was false image. He wanted to produce a false image, and in this case here she's trying to save the appearances and is willing to be artificial about it. All right. Now, Fellini worked with immature attitudes in actors and actresses, and they were even in some of his themes. But his films were not immature. Now, the next film director worked more extensively with the theme of natural aggression, primitivity, and base immature motivation, and their relationship to bravery, courage, and assertiveness in life. Akira Kurosawa. The sun is in Aries, which is a sign of courage and bravery and being able to stand up to things. It forms a mild and weak sextile to Mars, which is the only aspect it makes. So the sense of self isn't strong, and the sextile to Mars indicates he's trying to find himself. He's trying to find himself in the expression of energy or in the expression of bravery. Mars rules the ascendant, and it rules the sun sign. So Mars becomes exceedingly important in this horoscope, and it forms the strongest aspect, the Mars square the moon. Now the moon is defensive. The moon is rarely aggressive. It's protective. It's sort of like a mother hen that gets really huffy when something is threatening her chicks. Mars is offensive and assertive, and it can be very aggressive. So what he's trying to do in his expressions is trying to work out his character. He realizes that he has these primitive qualities in them, but he's trying to find himself as a matter of courage. And so what he does is, being a very civilized man, and he had very courtly behavior, he can't really rationalize the primitivity of the Mars square the moon. So he does the next best thing that he can do. He tries to produce brave men who can be vicious and aggressive and all of that, defending other people. And probably his most famous film, The Seven Samurai, which takes these seven men that have been very violent and uses them in the defense of innocent villagers. And so brings out a different side of the square in dealing with that subject. And that's all I have. Any questions, especially about the first horoscope?